God is good. All right, let's do our confession. Lord, I choose to obey your word, for as I dwell and walk in your presence, I shall not lack. Poverty be far from me and my household in Jesus' name. I will walk in your blessings, Lord. I will rise above all that hell has to offer and accept heaven's best here on earth. Everything I set my hands to will prosper because I make you my dwelling place. You are my refuge and my fortress. Thank you, Lord, for your provision. I accept it by faith, fully expecting your blessings in every area of my life. For wherever your presence is, there is no lack. Therefore, Lord, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for abundant harvest, health, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, scholarships and grants, inventions with royalties, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessings and increase, bargains and child support. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. It is Perception Month. Anybody, how many of you got 2020 vision? You know, I thought about that because last year in January, it was 2020. Remember that? And 2020 is supposed to be perfect vision, and all these preachers was talking about it was going to be a 2020 year and everything was going to be perfect, you know. And I don't think 2020 went the way everything we thought it might go, did it? And I will tell you something, though, that if there's one thing that we really need, we need to be able to see differently than we have in the past. I think it's one of the reasons why that the New Testament talks so much about opening the eyes of the blind, all right? And it's not always about physical blindness. It's way more about spiritual blindness. We live in a society today in the world where people are spiritually blinded. And it's literally comes back to scripture I shared last week. The God of this world has blinded the minds of people that they can't see. They can't see. They have no spiritual insight and cannot see with spiritual vision. I shared last week that the ability to see, perception is the ability to see. And not just with a physical eye. We see with a physical eye. We see each other. We see things. But more importantly, we can also see with a spiritual eye. We can have insight, spiritual insight, into all kinds of things that need to be seen into. Amen. If all I ever see is what's in front of me, then I'm going to live a pretty blinded life. That's all that there is to it. Now, know this today. Sight is a lot like hearing. Okay. You know that? Sight is a lot like hearing, in that sometimes we see what we want to see and we don't see what we don't want to see. So we could say that sight can be selective, just like hearing is. You know, how many times have we walked down a hallway and there was a piece of paper and we thought, I could bend over and pick that up, but, you know, we walk on by. Just a simple illustration, because every week there's a piece of paper on the floor, and I think, am I going to pick that up or let Angela vacuum it or Susan, because they're so good about cleaning sanctuary. And everybody say, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. So when you come in, it's clean, it's because they did it. If you come in, it's dirty, it's because I didn't. So I'll take that blame, whatever that it might be. But we all have a tendency to do that. It's like trash can at home. You know, you open the door and you put it in there and it's full, and you shut the door and walk off because you saw it, but you didn't see it. Like an ashtray. He walked out of the room so I can talk about him. Just notice that, okay? You walk out of the room, I may talk about you. But there's a certain individual who's really good about emptying an ashtray and never putting water back in it. But he'll put it back in the refrigerator. So you go to the refrigerator and there's no ice in the trays. They're all empty. Because you know he saw that it was empty, but he could not see himself filling it back up to put it back in the refrigerator. We've all got these. Can I have an amen? Some of you is looking at your spouses while I'm talking even, you know, because that's how that we are. It's like you take a shower and your towel stays on the floor. There's just so many different things that we choose not to see. And here's the kicker. When we choose not to see something, then we choose not to do something about what we just saw. Just the way that it works. I want you to know today that there is a mind and eye connection. And when I talk about your mind, I'm talking about your thoughts and your thought process. We know that our brain, our mind, is able to paint visible pictures. You can close your eyes today, and I've used this illustration lots of times in 29 years, but you can close your eyes and you can visualize a lot of different things. You know, I just visualized a hot fudge sundae with nuts on it. You know, you just never know where your mind's going to go, do you? How come we just never know where our mind's going to go? I'll tell you why, because your mind's been a lot of places. Some of them good, some of them bad, and your mind will take you back where you've been. Amen? And then a lot of times all it takes is seeing something to stimulate something that you've already saw, pictures that have already been painted, things that you've already visualized and been a part of or took place in. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad. Have you ever considered the fact that God gave us the ability to create within our mind pictures? And I remember one time reading, I can't think of his name. I could have looked it up, but I wasn't going to just come to my mind, so I didn't. But the individual who developed all the caterpillar equipment, he was an older gentleman, and he would go to bed at night, and in the night he would begin to dream about a piece of equipment. And he would dream about that. He was having night visions, all right? I definitely believe it was from God. And he would wake up in the middle of the night and he kept paper and pencil at a drafting table where he slept. And he would get up and he would draw that out, a blueprint of that piece of equipment that he saw. Next time you go by and they're building a big highway and there's a big, great big dirt mover there, just know this gentleman dreamed that in the middle of the night and got up and drew that picture out. And then later on when he was awake, he made it happen because he saw that was created in his mind. God has given us the ability to do so many things by being able to paint those pictures in our head. You can visualize a car, a house, a spouse. I'm telling you, you know, when I'm praying, I like to close my eyes. You don't have to, but I like to because when I close my eyes, I can visualize who I'm praying for or what I'm praying about. And so if I can visualize that, then I'll do a better job praying for it. And sometimes I can just close my eyes and then God will reveal something that needs to be prayed about. I'll see a face or a situation that I didn't know anything about or I had forgot about. So I thank God that it's there. Now the problem with that is that we all have an enemy, do we not? We know that the devil, that he continually bombards our minds with all kinds of thoughts, especially those things that's been a part of our past, because he knows all about your past. He knows every little dirty secret you got that you haven't told anybody, and the ones you did tell somebody and you wish you hadn't, he knows them. And he's going to use anything that he can against you. And so he knows that if you begin to see the thoughts that he places in your mind, you'll begin to create a new picture there, and it may not be a good picture. Because we have a tendency, you know, there's a saying that you can't literally just take it out of God's word, but yet it's still true, that seeing is believing. Because when you see something, you will believe it. That's just the way that it is, whether it's a lie or whether it's the truth. And a lot of times you'll see things that are a lie, but you'll believe those. And then sometimes, because there's no spiritual insight, we'll see something that's truth, but we won't believe that. I am really amazed at how that we can believe a lie, and the Bible says there's danger in that. Of course, one of the greatest dangers listed, mentioned in the New Testament is that there are those who will believe a lie and be damned for that. And I could preach on that for a few minutes, because if you believe a lie about prosperity and you don't trust God with your finances, then you won't be prospered by God. So you're actually, and I don't like using the word even, but you are actually damning your finances when you don't believe in prosperity. If you can't see healing in God's word and in those scriptures, then you're actually causing sickness and disease. You're giving it an open door for your physical body, because instead of seeing health and healing from God's word, you're seeing a lie, believing a lie. And if you believe that lie will come to pass. Because the truth is, whatever that you believe is what you're going to speak. It's going to, the pictures that are painted in our minds, that's what eventually what's going to come out of our mouth. Now, the question for today, and I titled today's sermon, Seeing Yourself. Last week we talked about seeing Jesus. Who do man say that I am? Peter said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus told him, man, you got it right. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. He was saying, Peter, you didn't say that because you see me with a physical eye. Jesus was telling Peter, Peter, you said that because you see me with a spiritual eye. You had insight into who I really am, and it's in your heart. And because it's in your heart, it's in your mouth, and you spoke that. And we all operate on the very same principle. What we see in our mind, the pictures that are painted there, whether it's by the world and by our past life, or whether or not it's by God and by our present life, what God's revealing to us, that's what's in our mind. That's what pictures that we're going to paint. That's what we're going to say. And when we say that, that's what's going to happen. See, I can answer this question for you. How do you see yourself? How do you see yourself? Now, when I look in the mirror, it depends on which hat I got on. On Sunday morning, I see myself as Pastor Dale, okay? On Monday morning, I'll see myself as MFA employee, generally speaking. If my grandkids are sitting on my lap, I see myself as Pawpaw. Sure. See, we all wear different hats and we do different things, and sometimes we see ourselves differently than we do at other times. That's all of us. But we actually all see ourselves according to the thoughts and the images that we have chosen to believe up until this point. What we have chosen to believe. Now, the devil's been lying to you. He's a liar, father of all lies. He tells you you're no good. He tells you that you're lower in dirt. He tells you that you'll never get clean. You'll never be healthy. You'll never find the right spouse. You'll never be married again. Your husband's going to cheat on you. I'm telling you, the devil's going to tell you a whole picture of lies, a whole plate full of them, because he wants you to dwell on those. And when you dwell on those negative thoughts, then it will paint a negative picture. And then out of that negative picture, you'll begin to speak. And of course, here we're talking about spiritual law. You got this one. Seeing is believing, generally speaking. Believing is speaking. Speaking is sowing, and sowing produces your future harvest. Okay? That's just the way that it works. It works whether you serve God or serve the devil. It works whether you believe it or whether you don't. It still works because it's spiritual law. This is the principle that every one of us have lived by, regardless of whether you're 18 years old, 63 years old, doesn't matter how old you are. You've been living this picture. When I was a boy, when I was young enough to play Little League Baseball, I could see myself pitching in Busch Stadium. I could see myself doing that. And I still blame my brother because I threw my arm out when I was young. And so I forgive you, Troy. I love you in spite of all that you did. Amen. And I tell him he needs to watch next Sunday's sermon, and then he'll accept my forgiveness, right? So, because anyway, how many of you saw yourself doing something that you never did? Amen. Probably everybody in this room. Ask a 7-year-old what they want to be when they grow up, and they've already got a picture painted in their mind. I want to be a car salesman. Anybody wanted to do that when you grew up? No, nobody saw that. But sometimes our dreams don't come true. And sometimes it gets changed, because as we get older, if we allow God to move in our life and begin to paint some pictures. See, the good news for me is that when I was young, I got saved in Assembly of God Church in Bernie. Because some caring people cared enough to haul us to church, be there for us, lead us to Jesus Christ. And then when I was a teenager, there were some people cared enough to invite me when I was being rebellious to come to church. And I was there, rededicated my heart to the Lord, because He didn't give me a choice. He just spoke to me, you know, in a very positive, powerful way. And then I've spent the last 50 years of my life in church. And so I've had a lot of word preached at me. And then I preached a lot of word at me too. Plus, I've studied a lot of word. So I've had a lot of infiltration of God's word. So when the pictures begin to get painted in my mind, I know the difference between what God's word says and what the world's telling me. So yeah, I do. I have an advantage over a lot of you in this room. And a lot of you, I don't have that advantage, because you have the same one. Now, for a lot of us in this room, you don't have that much here. I hate that for you. I do. That's why that we stress all the time to do what? Study to show yourselves approved. Read God's word. Get the word in you. Learn what God says about you. Because, and I ask you the question, how do you see yourself? Most of you would write that out on a piece of paper, and it would have had very little to do with what this says, and it would have had a whole lot to do with what the world has said about you in your lifetime. Because the world's been lying to you ever since you was old enough to recognize its voice. It tells you you're ugly, you're fat, you're poor, you're broke, you're no good. That's what the world says. It's a negative world with a negative confession about everybody. And then when you choose not to believe that, it still speaks negative. Even though we know what God's word says about us, we still have to deal with everything negative that comes in the world. I go to last week at work. Let me confess this one on my own. We were at work, and me and one of the guys was talking. And another one, he said something made me upset. He did. This guy said something made me upset. So I stewed on that for a while. Anybody know what that means, to stew on something that somebody said that you didn't like? And I had the perfect comeback. I'm telling you, it didn't take me long. I had it. I was ready for him. Okay, and then here I go out in the field, and I'm gone all day, and I'm still stewing on it because I didn't get saved, my perfect comeback. And you know what God's doing the whole time? And I knew it. I knew it. Here I am. I'm human, right? I was Brother Dale. This is on Monday or Tuesday. I wasn't Pastor Dale then. I was Brother Dale. Yeah. That sometimes I'm Davis's dad and sometimes I'm not, you know, or Kelly's dad. They remind me of that on occasion. Well, I'm like this with God. God, I had the perfect comeback. Come on. Come on, let me say it. Can I say it? Come on, let me say it. Of course, you know what God said, don't you? He didn't say a word. He didn't have to. I knew what was on his heart. Here's the truth, though, all right? Here's truth for you. When you look into this book right here, when you look into this, and you begin to see what's in here, then that's insight. God will give you insight into what this says and what it means. And when you begin to get insight into what this says right here, it will begin to change your physical sight. The insight in God's word changes your physical sight. So instead of you standing in front of the mirror talking about how you look, how you don't like your hair color, or how you don't like the weight you put on, all those things don't matter. God's not judging you by your outward appearance. I have a Bible over at my house that belonged to my great-grandfather. And I'm telling you, it looks rough. And the front cover is about half tore off, and he scribbled in it, and sometimes you can't hardly even read his scribble. But you know what? It's still got the Word of God in it on the inside. And it doesn't matter how the outside of that Bible looks, it's still the Bible. And it's still the Word of God, and it's still the truth. Because it really doesn't matter if this Bible's got a cover on it or not. What's important is what's on the inside. And that's just the way that you are in God's eyes. So yeah, maybe you're outside. The devil's lied to you and the world says that you're not pretty, you're not good, you're not perfect, you're not worthy, you're not... Because the devil's just going to lie. All he's doing is telling you what's on the outside. Because what's on the inside is what God put there. God breathed into you and you became a living soul and you were fearfully and wonderfully made and you are the apple of God's eye and God loves you just the way that you are in the shape that you're in and God wants you to begin to see things differently than what you have in the past so that you will not do the same things that you always did, be the same person that you always was, go the same places, get in the same trouble that you always have. Amen? But you've got to begin to see yourself differently than you did in the past. The light will come on. I've read scriptures. I know some scriptures 10, 15 times. And then one day I'm reading it and the light came on. And I thought, wow, that's what that meant. I always wondered what that meant. Amen? Because it wasn't time for me to know it then. Now it was time for me to know it. You know what I'm saying today? I'm saying that the supernatural overcomes the natural through spiritual insight. Because it's not about what you see. It's like our battle. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. My problem wasn't the guy who said something I didn't like. My problem was the devil stirred him to say it because the devil's trying to get my goat so I wouldn't have a good Monday or Tuesday, whatever day that it was. And if I'd allowed it to happen, it could have got hairy. Amen. Because when you deal with situations where the other party doesn't know God, it can get hairy on you pretty quick. All you got to do is come back with that perfect comeback, you know, because you'll find out the perfect comeback wasn't quite as good as you thought it was. And probably he's already got one prepared for you. And then where's it going to go? It's going to go somewhere that you don't want it to. Now let's look for a minute at God's Word. Matthew chapter 8, verses 20 through 27, we have a little incident that took place in the lives of some disciples and Jesus one day. And it says, when Jesus was entering into his ship, his disciples, they followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves. But Jesus, he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and spoke to him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And there's a couple other verses go with it. Look, and he saith unto them, why are you so fearful, O ye little faith? Then he arose, rebuked the wind and the sea, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is that, that even the winds and the sea obey him? Now, you see the difference between physical sight and spiritual insight in that scripture? Here we have these disciples been following Jesus, and they know who he is, but they don't know who they are. They knew who he was, but they didn't know who they were. And so they see the wind, they see the rain, they feel the ship rocking back and forth. They're afraid it's going to sink. It's coming over the boat. They're probably dipping some water out, looking for the shore. They've got their mind. Their mind is painting pictures of distress and worry and fear and unbelief and even to the point probably of death. We're going to perish out here. We can swim, but we can't swim in this storm. We're going to drown. How many times in life have you been in a situation where all that you could see was the bad? You didn't know how you was going to get out of it. You didn't know what was going to happen. You thought, this can't be good. The end, I don't know what the end's going to be, but it can't be good. And you get all concerned and worried and upset because all you can see is with a physical eye, the evidence that's there. Now remember a truth I taught you in the past. That they saw fact. They saw, yeah, the fact is the wind was blowing. And the fact was the waves were high. And the fact was the ship was rocking up and down. And the fact was if it capsized out there, they's all going to get wet. And the fact was if they couldn't swim good, they might drown. So there was a lot of facts there that they needed to deal with. And all you'll ever do with the physical is deal with facts. But here's Jesus. Where's he at? He's not concerned about facts. He's not concerned about how much your ship is rocking. He's not concerned about how high the waves may appear to you. He's not concerned about the fear that you've got in. He's concerned about you not being able to see him. Now, they had enough gumption and enough sense that they went and they woke him up. They woke up the truth because the truth overpowers fact every day of the week. In every single way. And so he didn't pay any attention. He didn't look at the waves and say, wow, them some big old waves. He didn't look at the wind and say, boy, that wind is strong. He didn't look at the ship and think, man, we need a bigger boat. No. He had spiritual insight. He knew who he was. See the difference? They didn't know who they were. They couldn't see themselves the same way that Jesus saw himself. Because he knew who he was. He knew who he was based upon God's word. Because he's the Son of God as well as the Son of Man. So what did he do? He spoke to it. Simple as that, wasn't it? He spoke to it. Peace, be still. And the wind ceased. And the waves quit. And the boat settled out. Because the truth superseded all those facts. Because the truth works. God's word does what? It works. The word works. Our newbies around here, you come back, you're going to hear that over and over and over and over again, because the only thing that works 100% of the time in everybody's life who believes it is this: it's the word of God. It always works. And when you can see yourself, because you've been in the Word, and you can apply the Word to the storms that you face in life, the Word will work for you to dispel every fact that's been real in your life, to dispel it, put it aside, put it out of the picture, be done with it. Because the Word always works. Now, spiritual insight comes from God for a reason. And that reason is to influence your decisions. Why do you need spiritual insight? Because you need to have influence when you make decisions. You need to know what the Word of God says before you go, before you do something that you're about to do. Go somewhere where you're about to go in every situation in life. Without spiritual insight, how many of us have made so many mistakes in our lives because we did not have spiritual insight into the next thing that we were about to take on? Yeah, every hand didn't go up, but every hand should have. And you know what? The truth is, every miracle that Jesus performed in the Gospels was performed under this very same basis, because he had insight. When they brought a lame person to him, did he say, "Oh, that's bad, you can't walk"? He said, "I got some new crutches down at the house, I'll bring them to you." No, he didn't see what other people saw, because he knew who he was. He saw the man healed. He said, "Rise up and walk." When they brought the blind, he opened their eyes. Why? Because he could see himself doing. He didn't look. Take notice. He didn't look at sickness. He didn't look at disease. He didn't look at pain. He didn't look at worry. He didn't look at poverty. He didn't look at anything, because he knew that he could fix everything. Because he's the answer. I wrote in a side note, he's a crack healer. Amen. He's not a crack dealer. He's a crack healer. And the Word of God will allow God to seal every crack that's in your life. Amen? Every crack that's in your life. You know what we have? We have the Saul syndrome. The people does. The Saul. You know who Saul was? He was that Pharisee. He's that one that was so smart. I'm telling you, he knew the Bible. He was a man among the Pharisees. He was up there. He could see so well, he couldn't see anything. He had perfect physical vision and absolutely no spiritual insight into the Word of God, even though he probably had more Word of God in him than what most people did at that time. He had religion. Yeah, he did. In Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 9, we have the story of him. There's an interesting verse down there that we'll get to. It says, And Saul, breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. And he said, "High priest, I need letters so I can go to Damascus, the synagogue, and when I find any of them that's in the Jesus way, whether they are men or women, I will bring them bound into Jerusalem." I'm telling you, he was bent on destroying Christians. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined around about him a light from heaven. My prayer is that the light comes on in your life. Amen. That God literally from heaven will lighten up your path so that you know that it's him, just like he did Saul. And what happened? Saul fell to the earth, and he heard a voice saying unto him, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" Hey, look, I'm telling you, the light has already come on. The light shined. All of a sudden, he was seeing spiritually insight. He recognized the Lord. And the Lord said, "You know who I am? I am Jesus, whom thou persecuted. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And he, trembling and astonished, said, "Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?" He's already seeing himself different, because the light came on. See, the light's got to come on. You've got to have some spiritual insight before you're going to know who you are and before you'll know what God expects and wants from you. And he said, Lord, what do you have me do? And the Lord said to him, rise, go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. They're still in the physical. They heard a voice, but they couldn't see who was talking. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. I got that underlined in my Bible. Because when his eyes were opened, he saw nobody. All of a sudden, he had been seeing Jesus with an insight, spiritual eye, but now his physical eyes have been blinded. And you know what? Sometimes, we're going to have to be blinded before we can actually see. Because as long as we're looking into this world and we're looking for it for answers and we're looking to people who don't know any better and we're looking in all the wrong places, then we're never going to be able to see the truth. And so the light, let me tell you, the light comes on in your life. All of a sudden you'll be blinded to what you don't need to see. Yeah, thank God. Just like Saul was. All of a sudden, it's changed in his life. He saw no man, but they led him by the hand, brought him into Damascus, and he was there 3 days without physical sight, and neither did eat nor drink. But you know what was happening in 3 days without physical sight? I'm telling you, he was getting some spiritual insight into who he was about to be. You know what his problem was? Same problem that most people that we know have today. He saw what others told him to see. He saw what others told him to see. Ain't it a shame that we've grown up in a world where parents talk bad about their kids? You're no good. You'll never amount to anything. You're just dumb. You know, some of the hardest words that we've ever heard came from some of the people that were closest to us in our lifetime. When we begin to deal with people as pastors, it'll always come back to their childhood. And it'll come back to generational things that's been carried down. And people had no clue what kind of curses they were placing upon their children and upon their grandchildren, because it passes from one generation to the next generation. And we hear we believe what we see, and we believe what we are told, and we go to school and you didn't do well on a test, and somebody said, well, you're just dumb anyway, you'll never amount to nothing. We've heard all, it'd be amazing what some of you have heard if I allowed you to speak right now. It makes some of us cry to know that you had to experience some of the things that you had to experience in your lifetime and how that has brought you to this place today. And it's helped to make you who you are. And so many of your struggles are because of what happened in your past. And when it comes to you seeing yourself, you see a part of the picture that you have painted about yourself is what others have told you. Now see, they told Paul, hey, you're a Pharisee. You're it, man. You've got it. You got it going on. He's full of pride. That's what he was. And you know what else he saw that most of us see? He saw what he wanted to believe. Sometimes we want to believe the lie. It's easier to believe a lie. It's hard sometimes to believe the truth. I remember when God called me to preach, it'd been a lot easier for me to believe, I don't think so, God. Yeah. I don't think so, God. I'm not so sure about this. You know who I am, right? Well, God did know who I was, and he did knew what the calling was on my life. So I had to make a choice. Did I want to believe what others was saying about me? Did I want to believe what I was feeling in my spirit? Did I want to see myself in a pulpit? Did I want to see that? How many times have you been told something and yet you did not really want to see yourself in that position? Maybe it's small scale, maybe it wasn't, maybe it was a lot of things. But yet, who we are is determined by what others have said and what we want to believe. We want to believe it. And that's sad, because most of the time, if you get in this book right here, all of a sudden you'll want to believe differently. You'll want to see yourself blessed. You'll want to see yourself. I preached healing for a long time. We had a young lady in our church at the time who had a problem. And she literally told me one time, if I get healed, I'd lose my check. I'll never forget that. You know what she wanted to believe? You know who she wanted to be? She didn't want to see herself healed. because the picture that it painted in her mind was one that required her to go to work and make her own living. And I'm like, wouldn't it be better to be healed, get a job, make your own living, feel good about yourself? But I could not answer for anybody but myself. Amen. Perception. How do we see ourselves? And you know what else Paul did? Paul saw himself as somebody. Now, this is a big one. Because when I began to encourage people to come to church, and you know what? There ain't very many people you witness to who believes they're going to go to hell when they die. They see themselves as being good. And they don't like the message that good people don't go to heaven. They don't like that one. It ain't good people go to heaven. I'm sorry if you're here and you thought that. I don't care how good you are. It won't get you into heaven's gates. Saved people go to heaven. Amen. And generally, saved people become good. Not always. We had that with grace and mercy. I taught you the truth about that. What's so terrible in life is that hundreds and thousands of good people have died and went to hell because they saw themselves as somebody without God. They believed in themselves without having a relationship with Jesus Christ. And you get somebody that's successful, they'll say, why do I need God? Why do I need God? What do you want me to come to church for? Why do I need to go to your church? They don't see themselves needing Jesus Christ. They don't see themselves needing a family to pray with them, to love and encourage them. They don't see themselves sitting on a pew every week because the pictures that are painted in their mind is them being successful, doing their own thing, going to places they want to go, experiencing all the things that they want to experience. Because still number one problem in America is pride, just like Paul had it. That's what he had. He was full of pride. He was full of selfishness. And I'm telling you, his life was full of problems. But God got a hold of him. When the light come on in his life, Jesus had a plan differently than what his was. Jesus did. You know what? Jesus got a plan probably that's differently than almost everybody in this room. Because we, in our past, we did not see ourselves the way that Jesus wanted us to see ourselves. Have you ever asked God, God, what did you want me to be when I grew up? What did you want me to be? Most of us be scared to ask probably now. But you know what? I can tell you, God didn't want you to be poor. God didn't want you to struggle with addiction. God didn't want you to be divorced. God didn't want you to struggle financially. God didn't want you to experience health issues. I about died last year. God didn't want me to die last year. God didn't want me to be sick last year. I allowed that to happen myself because I didn't see myself the way that I should have because I wasn't seeing myself in the light of God's word, even the way that I preached it, because I wasn't seeing myself. It takes work for us to see ourselves the way that God wants us to see ourselves. And we can't just get in the word once every 3 or 4 months and it happened to us. That's why it's so important that we study and we go to church and we fellowship together and we make friends of brethren and we visit together, encourage one another. It's why that we're taught to exhort one another daily. It's why when you're driving down the road and you see this house and they need prayer and you see this person and they need prayer and you see this person. It's why that these things happen in our life because God wants us to see the real picture. Amen. With spiritual insight and let it paint within our minds so that we can create a picture so we got something to say, something to speak, something to sow so that our future is way more determined than what our past has been. Because now I'm seeing myself differently. I still see this building full. Amen. I don't know why it ain't. Amen, Brother Brandon. I don't know why it's not. I look around today and I see chairs that I wish were full because I thought they should be here today. Where are we going wrong? Why is it that people will not commit? Because they don't see themselves committed. They don't see themselves sitting on that pew every week. They don't see themselves being a part of something that's never been a part of their past. And unless they allow God's word to paint that picture in their minds, they won't see it in the future. This is where we, the church, have failed people in our past because we didn't help to paint those pictures with our words. in their, to bring them to pass within their own life. You know what? Paul, the Apostle Paul, he had an amazing beginning. Think about that. An amazing journey was about to take place. You read the rest of the New Testament, and I'm telling you, you're talking about that man Saul, who became that man Paul, who gave his heart to the Lord and became the greatest apostle ever because the light came on within him. He started the most amazing adventure that there ever was. He experienced things beyond our imagination. I'm telling you, he saw people saved, healed, delivered. He was almost killed about 8 or 9 times. I'm telling you, he was delivered by the hand of God. He went to heaven and saw things that he was not even allowed to write in this book because he let the light come on. It changed his whole process of thought when the light came on. And it changed his course of history. It changed it because he let the light come on. Amen. Are we going to let the light come on? You know who I think about often? I think about Judas. I think about Judas Iscariot. The other disciple, the one who came and followed Jesus day after day, month after month. And you know what? He was there all the time. He was there everywhere Jesus went, he was there. And I'll tell you why. Because he carried their money. So they weren't going to go anywhere without Judas because just like me and you, we ain't going to go nowhere without a debit card, right? I don't have any cash, so Judas was always there. He saw everything that all the other disciples saw. He saw what Peter saw, what John saw, what Matthias saw. He saw everything they saw with a physical eye. He saw it with a physical eye. He saw the healings. He saw the miracles. He saw Jesus feed thousands and thousands and thousands. He saw it. It reminds me of the church that we've been a part of our whole life. It's the very same thing. You know, for everyone who doesn't have the Saul syndrome, they've got the Judas one. Yeah. And churches today in America and across the world are full of people who have the Saul syndrome and have the Judas one. And they see and they witness things, and yet they still choose not to believe it. And they cannot see themselves believing it and becoming different and be a part of something that they were never a part of in the past. Who was it that betrayed Jesus? Judas did. Why did he betray Jesus? Because he didn't see and recognize him as who he really was. His mind was still clouded about him being the Messiah. And the devil no doubt had painted pictures in Judas's mind, and you know what he saw? He saw prophet. He saw him telling them who the high priest, who Jesus really was, where he was going to be. He saw that money. He was looking down the road. What can I do with that money? Where can I go? What can I buy? What will happen to me? Yeah, it was amazing, really. So he sells them out, didn't he? Got his money. You know what happened when he got his money? The light came on. After all that, after 3 years of witnessing everything that he witnessed and then selling them out, and then the light comes on. And then all of a sudden he's like, what have I done? Have we ever woke up and we thought, what have I done? What have I done with my life? What have I done with all these years? What have I done? What am I doing? Because we didn't see where we were headed and where it was going to take us and what the end result was going to be. That's what happened to Judas. He threw the silver down, took his own life. He couldn't handle it. He killed himself because he never saw himself being anything like what Jesus saw him and told him over and over and over again. Huh. So what are we seeing today? Do we see what the Word says about us or not? Do you know what the Word says about you? Have you looked into it? This week, go over into the epistles and begin to read. Read what God's Word says about you. You're blessed, highly favored. I'm telling you over and over and over and over again, the I ams of this Bible belong to you. Now last week I told you who He was to me. This week, find out who you are to Him. I'm telling you, He calls us son and daughter. He's willing to bring us into the family. He's made a place for us. He's going to take care of us. The word after word after word are promises that are yes and amen and belong to me and you. Can we see ourselves receiving the promises of God? If you're here today and you're lost, can you see yourself kneeling at an altar today and saying, you know what, God, I need you. I need to see myself differently today than what I ever have in my life. It scares some people to think that I'll be different than what I was. Don't be scared. We bind up that fear in Jesus' name. You don't know who you are until you can see yourself in the light of God's Word. And when you can see yourself there, you begin to get an idea how good God is and how much that God loves you and how much that life can be different. No, don't be a Jesus. Don't be a Judas. Don't be a Saul. Do this. Do what the Word says. Get into it. Get into it. Do this Word. And then not only that, but speak this Word. Begin to paint that picture in your mind. Paint that picture. The Bible says I'm healed by stripes. The Bible says I don't have to be sick. The Bible says I don't have to experience pain. The Bible says I don't have to take and go to a doctor every month. The Bible says so many things about our life. The Bible does. So speak the Word and begin to paint that picture in your mind. And then the last thing I'm going to share with you is this. Don't wait until it's too late to make changes. Don't wait until it's too late to make changes. People do it all the time. All the time. They put it off. The old song we used to sing said, don't put off salvation too long. You preach as many funerals as I have, you know that sometimes people put it off. And you talk with people, I'm not ready yet, Brother Dale. I'm not ready to commit. I'm not ready. Got things I want to do. Life I want to live. I don't think that's for me, Brother Dale. Let me tell you, this is for you. This Word is for you. This life is for you. Jesus is for you. Salvation is yours for you to claim. A good life is waiting for you, a changed life, if you can just see yourself giving it all to Him. The Apostle Paul said, it's in Him that I live, I move, and I have my being. It's in Him. Let's stand together today. All right, let's go ahead and be blessed, and we're going to let Susan pray with Olivia, and that way we can move on along. All right, children, listen up. As you approach each day your battles, don't let your hearts faint. Fear not, do not tremble, neither be afraid. For the Lord our God is He that goes with us to fight for us against all of our enemies, to keep us safe. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes His face to shine upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord lifts up His countenance upon you and gives you His awesome and wonderful peace. Amen. All right.